mama say when I fall, and you may not think that I care for you, when you know deep down inside I really do. Maybe you need to show how deep is your love. It's your love around me. It's your love.
I really mean to love. Cause we live in a world of fools breaking us down, yeah, when they all should let us be. We belong.
Come on, let's say it one more time. Y'all help us.
How deep is your love? How deep is your love? I really mean to learn. Cause we're living in a world of fools breaking us down when they all should let us be. We belong to you and me. Yeah.
One more time for Yeba.
And I was proud of it. Do anything you ask me to. But before I knew it, you were running right with him. What the hell was I supposed to do? But what would you say if she was gone?
Hello, everyone. Good evening. Thank you for joining us. We will go ahead and get started with our program this evening, allowing folks who will trickle in, particularly given this very, very quick shift to moving us to Zoom for this conversation. But good evening and welcome to Artists as Neighbors, Living Liberation. My name is Aisha Williams, and I am the Executive Director of The Laundromat. I am Zooming in this evening from Bedside, Brooklyn on Lenape land, and very honor to be in space with you all this evening, particularly given the events of the week. As you all know, this conversation was originally intended to take place at one of our local Bedside Brooklyn community hangout spaces, Somewhere Good on Tompkins. I encourage you to stop by at some other point and check out their offerings. But given the weather events of the past few days, we are happy to be joining you here on Zoom. Thank you for weathering this shift, no pun intended, and joining us for what I know will be a dynamic presentation and engaging community conversation. Just an access note that because of the very quick pivot, we weren't able to secure a live CART transcription for this program, but if it is useful, you can access the closed captioning function at the bottom of the Zoom screen. And I will turn it over to my colleagues to get us started, but would just like to ground us in our reason for gathering this evening. At the LP, as we look across the landscape of our organizational home of Bed-Stuy, we see a rapidly shifting neighborhood in a fight to preserve its history, keep place, and hold space for remembrance. As an arts organization that supports artists as neighbors, we believe it is both essential and our responsibility to explore and understand the ways that public art can contribute to issues and concerns related to gentrification, displacement, and cultural erasure, and also be a resource to counter this disruption and serve as an asset for cultural preservation. And so I look forward to this conversation to come, the brilliant panelists that we are honored to be hearing from this evening, and also hearing your thoughts and reflections on this topic. And now I will turn it over to my colleague, Catherine Imbali Green Johnson, for a land acknowledgement.
Greetings all. My name is Trisha Barton. I'm the Senior Manager of Arts and Pedagogy with the Laundromat Project. And I'm here to talk about our land acknowledgement in general, just ancestral gratitude and respect. We respectfully acknowledge and honor that we are on traditional lands of the Lenape and the Canarsie, who have stewarded the land for generations. And we would pay our respects to the elders, past, present, and future. And more specifically, as we have our storefront in Bed-Stuy, we really care deeply about having our roots in Bed-Stuy. We really ask the community, including you, and specifically adding into the chat to speak on any elders that you would like to bring or highlight right now. So for example, I'm going to bring up my grandmother, which is Almeda E. Green Trish, and you can just add to the chat. We want to create a space where we're not only kind of thinking about the living, but also the past and the people that have brought us here to us to be able to hold the space that we do now hold together. And so you can add that in the chat for a few seconds while also taking into consideration the gratitude for the people who have stewarded this land in respects. I'm just going to speak on some names. I'm seeing Michelle Gamble. I'm seeing Virginia, Betty Yu's sister. Shirley Hawkins from Larry. Anna Burgess from Jamel. My nanny, Santosh from Diya. Joan Maynard. Marina Franco, Luis Sandana, Donna Maria, Fila, Ricky, Audrey Lord, and that makes me wanna speak out Octavia E. Butler, Lawrence Alexander, my great grandfather, Aisha Williams, Abe and Salome, excuse me if I get the last name wrong, Mathibe, Shamini Gibson, Eleanor Bryant, and I'm going to continue to let, please continue to add these names, Queen Elizabeth Green, Please continue to add these names as we want to pay our respects, but also create a welcoming space of not only the living, but also those who watch over us daily and by the second. I will now be passing it on to my colleague, Issa Saldana, for opening remarks. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I promise I'm the last person with remarks. I'm Issa Saldana, Senior Manager of Artists and Community Development at the Laundromat Project, reiterating that we are so grateful to have you all here for this community conversation, which will explore the dynamic relationship between public art and also the challenges of displacement that are faced by communities of color when public art begins to enter neighborhoods in new ways and in ways that are recognized as art, as opposed to the art and creativity that had always and always was there and always has been and will be there. And so today you will hear the perspectives of artists, activists, community leaders, and each other as we delve into how public art can be used in a different way instead of being co-opted in order to propel gentrification and displacement. We hope to explore how we can uplift legacies, preserve cultural heritage, and address the impacts of when public art is used in ways to further displacement. And we are lucky for our panel today to be joined by some members of the LP family. So Betty Yu, our moderator, is an LP artist alum and part of Chinatown Art Brigade. Our LP board member, Diya Vij, who is also curator at Creative Time and co-curator of Counterpublic 2023, is here with us as well. Larry Weeks, Fulton Art Fair founder, director, artist, curator, and also last year, a recent LP micro grant awardee through our Create and Connect program. Artist alumni, Jamel Burgess, who completed the Artist in Residence program last year, and who is also an arts and culture leader at many places, including Groundswell NYC, an activist organizer in East New York. I could go on and on about all the accolades and amazing different roles that all of these folks play in public art, but we're lucky enough to be able to hear firsthand from them today. So I'm gonna let them talk about their projects, their work. And before I do, just please know that we really want to hear from you as members of the community and folks who are invested in this conversation. So there will be time later for y'all to dialogue directly with one another and discuss the transformative role of public art in living and celebrating our liberation. So with that, I turn it over to you, Betty. Thank you all again.
Hello. Thank you so much. Those intros were great. First off, thanks so much to the Laundromat Project for hosting tonight's important program and discussion, and for the land acknowledgement, of course. I'm really excited to facilitate this discussion with my esteemed peers of social justice-oriented artists, organizers, and cultural workers. I am looking forward to learning alongside you all as audience members to hear about the ways that artists and cultural workers have helped advance social justice, cultural preservation, public art, and placekeeping that is for, by, and about our communities without becoming a force of displacement and gentrification of our longtime fellow residents of color. And so I just wanted to uplift some terms, some like common ground. And I'm sure everyone here is familiar with the term art washing. And I think that it's obviously very relevant to bring that term up today and how myself included in our panelists here tonight, will be talking about the ways that we are building up our own community and lifting up the arts and culture that has been in our communities for a very long time. But the term art washing, right, has been something that has been touched upon in the last decade or so in New York City. So artists and creative workers have often been perceived as the vanguard of art washing, right, which is the early stages of gentrification, in which an influx of artists, galleries, and cultural institutions end up displacing residents from their homes. That is the longtime low-income you know, residents of color, working class residents, immigrant residents. And many, in many cases, if we step back a little bit, this is intentionally orchestrated by real estate developers often, and city planners even, under the guise of neighborhood revitalization. So unfortunately, we see these art washing tactics happening in quote unquote, in air quotes, up and coming low income and neighborhoods of color across New York City and also across the US, right? But there is a growing movement of socially conscious artists who are sort of rejecting that, rejecting this trend and refusing to be pawns. So just a little bit about myself, and then I'm gonna throw out a question to my peers. I am a socially engaged multimedia artist, filmmaker, and educator, and activist born to Chinese immigrant parents on the ancestral lands of the Lenape people, which is currently referred to as New York City. I integrate documentary film, photography, and installation and new media in my work. I approach my work through social justice issues that are really personal to me through my own lens, family narrative, and community's history. And I draw, you know, tremendous inspiration from my own family's experience with immigration, displacement, labor exploitation, and anti-Asian violence in the US. And finally, I am a co-founder of Chinatown Art Brigade, and the Laundromat Project has been a longtime supporter of the Brigade, as well as my own work. But CAB is an intergenerational collective driven by our fundamental belief that our cultural, material, and aesthetic modes of production have the power to advance social change. The Brigade is comprised of Asian American and Asian diasporic identifying visual artists, media makers, writers, educators, residents of Chinatown, and organizers with deep roots in our communities that we organize in. And so together we make art that centers art and culture as a way to support community-led organizing efforts around issues of gentrification, displacement, and abolition. And so since 2015, we've worked very closely with CAV, the Chinatown Tenants Union, who's been organizing since 9/11 against displacement and gentrification, which has accelerated quite a bit in the last 10 years. So we've used tactics and cultural organizing strategies like story circles, tenant-led placekeeping walks, large-scale public projections at night, to highlight organizing efforts and stories of tenants, mapping project using augmented reality, and of course, direct action. And we've used these platforms to really unleash our own collective imagination about what is possible and what a liberated future really could look like that is based in our material conditions. And we see that in the last 10 years, like in a lot of neighborhoods in Brooklyn, but in Manhattan's Chinatown, we've had over 130 galleries, mainly commercial galleries, that have replaced mom and pop small businesses. And these are the Trojan horses that real estate developers rely on, right, to raise the property values. And these galleries are a small part of this larger ecosystem of gentrification, but we have organized to hold them accountable through anti-art washing walks, through asking galleries to sign a 10-point pledge, platform pledge, to really fight displacement, along with other ways that we've really tried to hold them to account. And then finally, more recently, we've been part of a growing movement calling for the abolition of all oppressive systems, and specifically predatory housing practices and the carceral system. And we've been engaging in creative activism to support the fight against the city's displacement of the working poor and the plans to build a jail scraper, right? The tallest jail in the world in Chinatown that they're building it. So we've been connecting the fights around abolition and gentrification in recent years. So now I turn to my panelists. I just wanted to give you a little background about myself and the work that the Brigade is engaged in. But I wanted to start with a question around public art, and maybe I can toss this to Larry as the first person to tackle this question. How do you think public art can be used as a tool to address the challenges of displacement and gentrification, particularly in our communities of color? So I'm gonna just toss it to Larry to tackle first. And thank you again, everyone, for being here, Diya, Larry, Jamel. You might be on mute, Larry.
Okay. The first thing is to maintain cultural identity. There's a lot of artwork in the community that the greater community is not aware of. I mean, it amazes me that I live across the street from the Kingsborough houses, and on the grounds of the Kingsborough houses is a major piece of artwork by a Harlem Renaissance artist, Richmond Barté, that was allowed to fall into disrepair. Fortunately, we were able to get the city council to allocate $1.8 million for renovation. This is a piece of artwork that depicts African-Americans in a community that is by an African-American artist. So we have things of that nature that a lot of people say they were never aware that it sits there. And so first of all, we have to educate the people about the treasures that are in our community. I live down the street from the Brooklyn Children's Center, which has an 80-foot long piece of artwork by one of the earliest Afrofuturists, Emmett Wigglesworth, that the public is not be able to experience because it's behind closed doors. So there's artwork. There's also renowned artist Otto Niels, who has work on the grounds that people cannot see. You have to go inside the grounds to see this artwork. And there's artwork all throughout the community that the public doesn't get to experience. So there's that historical context, and then the inability for emerging and community and non-trained artists to present their work. And that was why Fulton Art Fair was established. No, I am not the founder of Fulton Art Fair. Fulton Art Fair has been going on. I'm old, but I'm not. Fulton Art Fair has been going on for 65 years. It's been going on for 65 years, and it was started by an African-American businesswoman. She owned a funeral home in Bed-Stuy, and she wanted to create a more positive image of Bed-Stuy. Her history is lost. I cannot find a picture of this woman. So we need to document our history and make it part of everyday life. And that way we can build upon, especially for our young people, that they can see that they're important to the community and the contributions that their elders and the ancestors have made. It. That's when I feel one of the major things is for Fulton Art Fair is to continue the legacy of the artists. We just completed today putting up banners on the fence at Robert Fulton Park, because we're getting ready to go do the on the fence for the next three weekends, public outdoor display of artwork by community artists. And we just putting up 20 banners that depict the artwork of former Fulton Art Fair members. So that's the role that I feel Fulton Art Fair needs to address is maintaining history and providing opportunity for community artists.
Can you, Larry, before I pass it on to Jamel, can you talk a little bit more about the rich history of the Fulton Art Fair? And you mentioned it was a businesswoman who started it, and just amazing. I did not know that it has a 65-year history. That is absolutely just what a treasure to celebrate. And can you tell us more about how you've been, because of the changes in the neighborhood, continuing to constantly, like you said, educate young people about what is already here in this neighborhood, and encouraging that sort of resiliency of artists in the neighborhood, right? We've had this in the neighborhood for so long. Has that been hard to kind of continue, right? This legacy?
Yeah, it's hard to continue the legacy. Like I said, unfortunately, Fulton Art Fair has gone through several transitions. Basically, it was started by Shirley Hawkins, who I put in the chat, and that was her name. And she owned a funeral home on Breveport and Bedford in that area. And she wanted to present a more positive image of Fulton Art Fair. And she approached Jacob Lawrence, who was actually living in Fort Greene, and Ernest Critchlow, who was also living in Fort Greene, about starting the Fulton Art Fair. And the emphasis was that artists at that time, especially artists of color, did not have opportunities to display their work. So they would come out and display their work along the fence across from Boys and Girls High School on Fulton and Harriet Tubman Boulevard. A lot of folks get that one confused too, sometimes how Harriet Tubman Way, but it's actually Fulton Street and Harriet Tubman. And a lot of people are not even aware of that, that it is co-named Harriet Tubman. So it's just another example where the history gets lost. So the Fulton Art Fair wants to document these artists, and we place today, I believe, 20 banners that depict the artworks and a short bio of some of the longtime Fulton Art Fair members. And that's something that we've been doing for several years. And so that's the way we support the history. And current artists, we have events that we sponsor. We have displays all over the metropolitan area. We've done exhibits at WBGO Radio. We've gone to Newark. We've gone to Harlem. We've gone to JCAL, exhibits in all of those venues. So it gives artists the opportunity to display their work in other venues and hopefully sell some work.
Thanks so much, Larry. Same question to Jamel. How do you think public art can be used as a tool to address these challenges around displacement, particularly in our communities of color today?
Thank you. Thank you so much. And it was super inspiring and information to hear Larry speak about some of that rich history. For me, I always think of art as a tool to educate, to activate, and to move people, and thinking of using public art in this space for discourse, for critical conversations, and to move people, whether it's through physical action, movement. I have like audio backgrounds, whether that's dance, but then also direct action. And that's the power of public art, right? And so, you know, museums are cool and everything, but being able to create work in community, in space, and in a background that is aligned with folks who are doing advocacy efforts, or folks who are mobilizing to like address specific issues, or you know, educate community members, it's very critical, and it's important, especially in times when we look at, you know, the rise of displacement and the erasure of certain neighborhoods. And in the work that I'm doing with the East Brooklyn Archives, it's really just that stamp and that reminder, like, that we are here, we lived here, we exist. As Larry said, you know, there's so much rich history that unfortunately sometimes it gets diluted or gets lost. And to be able to activate or tap into contemporary artists to speak to the past, thinking about how we are built and stand on the shoulders of strong artists, organizers, and ancestors. And then, you know, what impact could that have into our future and the way we address contemporary issues like displacement, the rezonings and gentrification of certain neighborhoods, is so important and critical to have. And just one example I'll provide is last year, with the support of the LP, which was amazing, I led a series of workshops with young people looking at the history of East New York. And I pulled from the archives from the 60s an article about a family called Meet the Petersons, where they organized their block to fight the redlining, not redlining specifically, but blockbusting, one of the tactics used to like force people to sell their blocks and move out into the suburbs. And anyway, the Petersons, this family, they organized their block and created these banners and signs on their neighborhood in East New York, stating this home is not for sale. And this was in the 60s. And you know, it was such like a light bulb moment when I had found that article in the archive, and then being able to bring that to the neighborhood think about the contemporary movement, working with community land trusts and other folks who were organizing to fight the rezone and preserve and protect East New York. There were similar calls for those actions to, you know, East New York is not for sale, our homes are not for sale. And then to be able to distribute those articles as prints and for young people and organizers to see that direct connection and how that can inspire and activate folks, you know, to continue to do the work and just make that connection to know that rich history and those shoulders that we stand on. So, yeah.
Yeah, that's beautiful. Thank you so much. I got fired up as you were talking. Can you also talk, I know you also do a lot of work with Groundswell, who, you know, is a beloved organization that's done such amazing mural work across the city. And can you talk about the really interesting community engaged approach that you all have had from the beginning around working with communities in a way where you always make sure that these murals are not a tool for art washing or beautification, right? Quote in all air quotes, like you were talking about in neighborhoods, but that it's really by and from the community. I think it's such a beautiful kind of organizing approach that everyone should know about. So if you can talk a little bit more about that, that'd be great.
Yeah, sure, definitely. And you know, it's an important model. I love it. And, you know, I love Groundswell. Groundswell is an amazing organization. We've been around for over 25 years, over 600 murals across the city. But one thing I can say, that model has always been around, right? Within communities, people using art, working collectively to design, address issues and incorporate folks for a public work. And, you know, one way I differentiate is, you know, not anybody, you know, people could do murals, but community murals is a complete different process. And with Groundswell, our model from start to finish, it's an emphasis on that community engagement. Like the work doesn't exist without the community input. And then, you know, when people sometimes see art, they see the final product and they, you know, that's amazing. It is great seeing the mural and the paints and the kids and everything, but the process is just as important, if not more significant than the final product. And so there's these different touch points throughout that process, the community vision and sessions, conversations, community paint days, community dedications, where, you know, it's multi-generational. You have young people, you have the lead artists, you have the seniors. People are integrated throughout this process to contribute. What do they want to see? What colors, what concepts, what themes do they want to address in the mural? They come and actually help paint the mural with the lead from, you know, the direction and leadership of a lead artist and assistant artist. Their names are on those murals. And so it's not just one person's work of art. And that also helps upkeep that piece in the neighborhood, allows people, a variety of stakeholders, to see themselves as part of the process, to see themselves in that work, to protect, to preserve it, and then also inspire folks to continue to, you know, address whatever the theme or the topic was that's being addressed in that mural, and just continue to replicate that process throughout their communities.
That's beautiful. Thank you, Jamel. Diya, last but not least, same question around the role of public art. I know you wear several hats, but you know, if you want to speak to it, starting with your role at Creative Time, what are your thoughts about the ways that public art can be used as a tool to address these challenges around displacement?
Yeah. Well, thank you to the LP and to these amazing co-panelists. I'm already just like soaking so much in, and I am grateful to be here alongside you all. The first project I ever got to work on as in the arts was Immigrant Movement International, a project initiated by artist Tanya Bruguera with the Queens Museum and Creative Time in 2010, and it was a storefront in Corona, Queens that was initially kind of thought of as conceived of to be a political party for undocumented immigrants and new residents. And it, because nonprofits were supporting it, it couldn't explicitly be a political party, but it did become this community center in which a lot of new immigrants to the neighborhood were able to kind of make their own space. And within that kind of community building and convening came a lot of political education, and it lasted for 7 years. It was a really long-term project and kind of new and sustained community asset. And from that, gathering space, all these other artist collectives were formed, like Mujeres en Movimiento, Women in the Movement, a group of undocumented mothers or mixed status mothers that began organizing together for local safety rights and rights for their families. For example, they really took on some pretty intense local politics and local political actors in order, very racist political actors, in order to get bike lanes put on Roosevelt Avenue, and had really started doing this like community change grassroots work. Mobile print power became a really active, amazing mobile print making studio that's in support of activist movements and protests. And so from that experience, I really learned from the beginning that art, and especially public art, has the capacity to support local organizing efforts and also to kind of really catalyze material change and shifts in material conditions. And that's kind of been my curatorial lens ever since. And as a curator of public art, I also think about my responsibility in supporting artists to support community, and in doing so to support resource redistribution into community and community-led efforts. And I think most recently, I guess I'll talk a little bit about Counterpublic, a St. Louis-based triennial, public art triennial that I co-curated with four amazing curators: James McCannelly, actually a few Counterpublic, James McCannelly, Catherine Reynolds, Allison Glenn, Risa Puglio, and New Red Order. And we really went into that. It was the second iteration of this triennial. We really went into it asking, what is a anti-gentrification public art triennial look like? And with that lens, there was some really deep, several year long community engagement process that resulted in us doing things like, I'm working with artist Jordan Weber, who had been working in St. Louis for years with a lot of local anti-gentrification and also abolitionist groups, from the Arkley Defenders to Close the Workhouse. And he was commissioned to make a permanent rain garden, which in a place called Peace Park, which actually like a community reoccupation of a former park or former space that was initiated by a civil rights leader, that was a kind of a center for mutual aid and resource sharing, food distribution, sharing of tools and other kind of support systems in the neighborhood. And then it was completely divested from, and the community has been advocating to bring that back, turned it into a land trust. And this project was actually able to move resources in order to get to the realization of that park in part, while also addressing really significant issues of water toxicity and overflow in the neighborhood by being a rainwater capture garden. And there's like so many examples within Counterpublic of that kind of work of raising money to rematriate the last remaining mound, Sugarloaf Mound, to the Osage Nation. That was an effort led by New Red Order and Counterpublic. So really all of the projects thought so much about how art can be a tool and a catalyst for that kind of redistribution or that reparative thinking. And another project from that triennial that I'll lift up is Black Quantum Futurism's Community Future Labs, that's unfolding throughout the run of Counterpublic, which is like a site for both art making and tenants' rights organizing, and some really direct action organizing. So it was this really incredible opportunity to think at a city scale how that might be possible to do both, to do something that energizes the local and national arts and dialogue between the two in a city that doesn't have much art infrastructure, while also having an anti-gentrification lens. Like, what does it look like to use art to really support community?
Great, thank you, Diya. This is segues really nicely into sort of the next question around the importance of community engagement. And I think all of you have already really addressed it, but maybe more specifically, you know, what role does community engagement, like with nonprofits or, you know, activist groups and collaborating with them, play in the development and implementation of these public art initiatives, especially in these neighborhoods that are transforming rapidly? And I'll just speak a little bit for Chinatown Art Brigade. As I mentioned, you know, when we started in 2015, our partnership with the Chinatown Tenants Union of CAB in Chinatown, you know, we saw like within just about 7-8 years, sort of 30 to 40% of the Chinatown residents being displaced, mainly elders who are renters and low income, right? As a result of 9/11, the land grabbing, the block, sort of the block by block kind of selling off or buying off by these developers. And now we're seeing, you know, in the last like 7 to 10 years, the galleries and the gentrifiers and the condos coming up, the largest, the tallest condos in, you know, on the East River, right, in Two Bridges and Lower East Side. And then of course there's the jail scraper that is going up, which is also a part of this larger landscape. But when we started out with the Chinatown Tenants Union, and, you know, we really took their lead. We had a certain plan for our 2-month workshop series that we would do with them. But then that, you know, working with the tenants, it was really clear that, you know, the relationship building and the trust that was paramount. And so we started with story circles and then placekeeping walks, tenants leading us to places of resilience or resistance, meaning places that are no longer there that were very meaningful to them, and places that are still there and fighting the good fight, like Wing on Woe, which is the longest running storefront, 120 years now in Chinatown. And so we sort of started to do mapping and envisioning what a future of housing justice could look like, that, you know, is where there's an abundance of all these things that we care about, and including obviously affordable housing and rezoning that is led by the people impacted. And so we did these projections, we incorporated placekeeping walks and you know, mapping and art making, and all sort of led to a series of projections at night. And a lot of the community members and the tenants said, you know, we want to reach other tenants to let them know about this organization, what we're doing. And they work 12, 14 hours a day, like most working people work a lot. And so they presented this idea of projecting on walls at, you know, between 8 and 10 at night, which we did. And it was a great way to engage with people who are coming out of the subway, buying groceries, you know, and it really was a really amazing organizing tool for the organization to kind of have this moment to talk about the forces of gentrification, not just individuals, but the larger, you know, structural system of displacement at work. And so I'm just, you know, wondering what, if you all have stories or experiences to share, or just thoughts around the importance of community collaboration, whether it be with nonprofits or activists, as a way to engage in these public art initiatives. And I know all of you have spoken about it, but maybe more directly, maybe pulling out another example from your own work. And I'll start with Larry again, and then we'll go to Jamel and then Diya.
Well, Fulton Art Fair engages the public by having the artists outside on Fulton Street every year. So you see families come through with their children who probably don't go to museums, that probably don't see artwork created by people that look like them. So that's one of our major community outreaches. Last year, we started a new event, which we're going to continue every year, which is an art walk where we identified locations. We included the galleries that in community, and we put together a map and had people walking through Bed-Stuy and Weeksville. And we provided a bus that would shuttle people back and forth to some key locations. So, and that was another public outreach. The Richmond Bartel, we want to seek from the tenants, not the tenants, the residents of Kingsborough photographs to document their interaction with the freeze, because these images will be used to populate banners that would go on the construction fence starting in July. So we're reaching out to the residents of Kingsborough houses and seeking photographs from them, and also going to solicit artists to create artworks that relate to the theme of the Exodus and Dance is the name of the freeze. So those are ways we're going to be reaching out to the community besides having events in different locations. We've displayed at Restoration Plaza, we've in Bed-Stuy and these, you know, storefronts and participation in the street festivals. We had artists out on Tompkins Avenue last year during their street festivals on Sundays, and we'll have artists after we finish the June On the Fence event. So we encourage our artists to get out and display their work to the public and hopefully sell their work to the public.
That's great that you have a bus that you provide transportation, right? I mean, that's just, you know, in terms of accessibility, that's amazing to offer that.
Yeah, because it's you're talking about an area that was probably a 30-minute walk from end to end, because I thought it was important to include Weeksville in the conversation, and to get all the way back down by Flushing Avenue, it's a trip. Mm-hmm. So the bus made limited stops, and we're working on planning on that, doing that again in probably late October.
That's amazing. That's great. So same question to you, Jamel, around, you talked about it already, but if you have another example you want to share around like the importance of community partnerships.
Yeah, I guess like the way I'll summarize it is for my practice and for the work that I do too with Groundswell is that, you know, the art is in the community. Like that's it, and like that being the foundation, like the art of like gathering with community, the art of breaking bread, you know, the art of being in physical space, like and seeing the work, like Larry was mentioning too, like the artist actually doing the work in real time. That's how it differs from, you know, the traditional art making on the museum spaces. You know, a lot of murals, you know, sometimes people can fabricate them in the studio and then do them large scale or do them in the wee hours of the morning where there's less crowd and traffic and stuff like that. But the process, the way we do it is really, you know, during the time where there's traffic, where people are interacting, seeing it in real time, seeing it go up, having conversations with the young people and the artists fabricating that mural. That's, again, as I mentioned, like that process, that's the critical part. And even going back to what you had mentioned too, Betty, around like having the projection, you know, during those hours between 8 and 10, like that 8 and 10, that's the thing. You know, you really genuinely want to meet the people where they're at and meet in the community. And there's so much power in that, that, you know, that should be the foundation. That should be the art of it, and the practice. And, you know, something I was thinking is when I was hearing folks talk was just like really just being genuine in that, like that interaction and connecting with young people, multi-generation, like seniors, that it's not a transactional, like, oh, we want you to come to do this thing, but it's like a transformative lens where we need you to be a part of this so this thing can actually exist. Like, you know, it's for us versus like it's me doing this thing. And, you know, the last thing I'll say is there's this song, you know, which side are you on, my people, which side are you on? And so when you're doing that community work and you're engaging with public art making, like that's the lens you want to think about. Like, well, who am I doing this for? What am I doing for the people? Is it for the freedom? Is it for the movement? And be centered in that.
Yeah, absolutely. Diya, same question. And you gave such a great example with Counterpublic. And I don't know if you want to expand on that a little bit more or talk about some of the other work, because I know you've been engaged in so many projects over the years.
Yeah, well, maybe community engagement takes so many shapes and forms. I think even in what Larry and Jamel said, there's like, and what Chinatown Art Brigade is like such a shining example too of this kind of work. It takes so many forms, and I think different strategies lead to different outcomes or different kinds of meaningful participation. And one kind of smaller, and sometimes it's like engaging a whole lot of people, and sometimes it's engaging just a few. And I'm thinking I'll give like a couple examples, but part of Counterpublic, I worked with artist Stephanie Jameson, who's a filmmaker, sculptor, multimedia artist, multi-interdisciplinary artist, writer. who has a practice of collaboration. And she went into this project in this zone that is now downtown St. Louis. And currently it looks like a lot of parking lots and big motels and in historic train station that's now an indoor outdoor mall and some, you know, big grassy areas and some municipal civic buildings. But up until 1955, it was a really bustling Black neighborhood called Mill Creek Valley. And it was the birthplace of ragtime. It was the birthplace of a lot of musicians and like Miles Davis, Josephine Baker. It had hundreds of schools and churches. It was this really, really bustling, vibrant, mixed income neighborhood. And it was complicated, but that was a really big presence in the city. And in 1955, the aldermen voted to raise it in like the dark of night. And they did, they wholesale burnt the neighborhood down and moved everybody out, which is like a kind of legacy of St. Louis, that kind of big urban destruction, urban renewal, urban clearing, urban renewal projects. And it's almost forgotten history. So until really recently, there was no trace of Mill Creek Valley in the neighborhood, and there was no, there wasn't a lot of like cultural knowledge anymore in this generation of that space. So artist Damon Davis, St. Louis artist and activist, actually is making a mile-long monument to the families of Mill Creek Valley that marks each one along a mile-long stretch of land. But Stephanie was really thinking about all of the artists and musicians in St. Louis that leave, that like so many of them leave because opportunities are elsewhere. And she's thinking about migration, and she's thinking about the kind of absence of any trace of what was that neighborhood, not even ghosts or like, you can't feel that energy anywhere. It's just these parking lots. And so she collaborated with a duo, Jackie and Papa Wright, St. Louis performers, improvisational drummers, Papa, storytellers, Jackie, and they spent like almost 8 months working together on a sound piece about Josephine Baker, but also about Mill Creek Valley. And it plays in a Ferris wheel in that historic train station that probably was a really important space for migration in and out of St. Louis for many decades. And when you're listening to it, they name these venues that used to be there and the intersections where they were, and you can see it from the kind of bird's eye view of the Ferris wheel. And it's this was this really long-term collaboration with these folks that have been performing in St. Louis for 50 years. And what that did for that relationship, but also for the audience and listeners is also a transformation, even though it's not at the same scale as projecting to thousands of people, right? It's like this opportunity to kind of really go deep with just a couple of people versus, I would say, like a project I worked on, which you participated in, Betty, which was Red Stage, Richie Johnson's Red Stage and Astor Place, which is kind of more like what Larry is saying, that taking up of space. Which was a month-long public stage in Astor Place, in which I invited artists and organizers to use this really public intersection right off the subway to do things like Chinatown Art Brigade did an abolitionist teach-in. It was summer of 2021 when COVID restrictions were just lifting. Stonewall protests led by Queen Jean did a takeover on Pride that was also kind of rooted in abolition. And Morgan Baskis, an anti-Zionist, bat mitzvah, that was a Palestinian rights teach-in and also a performance. We had conversations on housing rights and all kinds of things. And it was this opportunity to take up space, that kind of political education through performance and making. And I named those two as like really different examples, but also both examples of kind of community engagement. And there's such a spectrum between. So I think it's interesting to kind of parse that out too. Like what are all the ways we name community, and sometimes going that deep, that small and intimately is also just as transformative as going big and loud.
That's a really good point. Thank you for providing those two examples around the long-term community engagement versus you know, sometimes the short term, like you said, with the big impact. So we have, before we sort of do our breakout session, breakout groups for folks to talk to one another, the audience members, one quick rapid fire, like maybe 1 to 2 sentence response to this question, which I'm always interested in, how folks sustain themselves in this work, this very intense hard work that we're all doing. So the question really is, how do you sustain yourself? What brings you joy? I know it's very personal, but anything you're willing to share, because I think it's helpful for folks who've been doing this for whether it's 5, 10, 30 years, it's the, you know, that self-care is really important in community, of course. But Larry, I'll ask you, what sustains you and what brings you joy?
It brings me joy when an artist says, I sold a piece of artwork.
Great answer. I love that. Jamel, what brings you joy and sustains you?
Being close to the young people. Yeah, it's just something about the young energy, the creativity, the imagination, and knowing that the work that we do, the advocacy, the art is, you know, it's all in their futures, benefit them directly. And so, yeah, working with the young people.
That's beautiful. And Diya, what sustains you and brings you joy?
My community of artists and peers and yeah, my community sustains me 100%. And also my nephew and niece.
Yes, yes. I was gonna say, what brings me joy right now? I'm in baby glow mode. I have a 14-month-old son, Junius, and he brings me joy because I every day look at him and remember why we do the work that we do and we must continue to move onward. So so he's my joy. And what sustains me. So we're going to transition into, I believe, I should just say that please look at the chat. There's tons of links, that panelists have referenced their own organizations and projects, and you'll find those links in the chat. But also, I'm going to share the prompt, and I think it will be in the chat as well. I believe we'll be broken up into 4 small breakout groups and a laundromat project staffer will sort of lead each breakout group. But the question is, you know, after hearing all of the panelists, what role do you think that you can play as an artist or a cultural worker, concerned citizen? I recognize that everyone's an artist here in this space, as a neighbor, to enrich our own communities without contributing to displacement. And another way to look at it is can you think of new ways that arts and culture and organizations can support these efforts? So it's twofold that will be put into the chat, role that you can play and the role that you think new ways that arts and cultural workers and organizations can play. And that can, you know, maybe that'll lead you somewhere else, but maybe as our starting question, and we're hoping that, just to be mindful of everyone having a chance to chime in. And then I think we're going to ask one person to just maybe sum up very briefly at the end of what you all, you know, just summing up what you all discussed. And then we'll come back for the Q&A for the panelists. Yeah, I believe we have 10 minutes and there will probably, I don't know if I'll pass it to Issa. I don't know if you'll get a time, you know, how many minutes are left kind of cue in the chat or something. But yeah, so those are the questions for the breakout group.
Thank you for so much for that just informative, rich, beautiful historical panel. I'm excited to continue the conversation in these smaller groups. I believe that another member of the LP team is going to send us into those groups for 10 minutes. And so we'll get to meet a few of you and you'll get to meet each other. And then we'll come back and all chat together with our amazing panelists. So you should receive a prompt to join a breakout room.
I think what's the word? Free for 10 minutes, I believe. I don't think we. Okay. Let me just put us in gallery mode for myself so I can see everyone. Okay, I think we're all back. I know that I and the other panelists were not in a breakout group, so I'm not sure what the configuration was, but an overview or some takeaways of just a couple of sentences, because I don't think we have that much time for a report back. But it would be great. I don't know if someone wants to volunteer from each group. Maybe we can start with Issa's group, if you were in a breakout group. Is there someone from your group that wants to just sum up?
Yeah, I'll share the two big takeaways, and I'll turn it to Tasha to go a little bit more in depth in something I hope we can discuss in the Q&A, which is we discussed how important it is and how clear it is to community members when someone doesn't know who is who and where is what, and they're bringing in their own concepts and not doing the work of digging into the archives, those physical archives that Jamel mentioned, and also the archives that are people in the neighborhood. And we talked a little bit about facade work and design being done collaboratively. So what are the ways? And if you're interested in that at all, our panel tomorrow, we'll talk a little bit more about that. But thinking about how architecture and design can serve communities who are already there instead of an imagined future community who people want to bring in. And then last but not least, I want to turn it to Tasha to share this point, but thinking about the artists themselves who find themselves in a place of sort of entrapment, being positioned against the community, wanting to have opportunities as an artist to do their work. And so Tasha, if you want to say a couple sentences on that, you can turn it over to the next group.
Thanks, Issa. What I mentioned is that I am familiar with an artist, well, speaking about the art washing, when sometimes artists either find out that they're being used as a pawn within this art washing scheme, and how then do they navigate that circumstance, leaving that situation unscathed, right? And then what are the ways to find out if they're a part of an art washing scheme, right? And so what immediately came up to me was an example that happened with Ed Woodham, who I am close to, founder of Art in Odd Places, which is a festival in New York that specifically speaks and uplifts public art. And another artist, I believe from Chicago, named Samantha Hill. They were residents at the Macon Hill residency back in 2016. And in speaking to community members, they then realized that they were part of an art washing scheme. And so they were terminated by the residency within 21 days of a 4-month time. So even in that part, there's like gaslighting. You know what I mean? So there's a stigma put against the artists who are trying to be integrous to the community. So I just really wanted to hear more of what that conversation would look like, because a lot of artists will find themselves with these opportunities, which they should get, which they are absolutely worthy of, but that shouldn't be at the cost of the community and what they want, and compromising the integrity of the artist.
That's such a great question. We should hold on to that question for the Q&A. That's like such, I think a lot of us are thinking about that in the times that we're grappling with, do we do this? Do we not do this, right? Because we all have to feed ourselves and pay rent and not, like you said, compromise our principles. I'm not sure if Aisha or Catherine led a group. Actually, maybe if one of you wants to, or someone from your group wants to report back and sum up.
Yeah, I think maybe unless anybody from my group wants to share, I will share just one piece of feedback for the sake of time, is just the
the doing of the work around uncovering of the histories, of the stories, of the narratives of a community is a way to fight against, or a way that artists are combating displacement by making folks aware of what the histories are, is that automatic just counterpoint to any alternative narrative that might be presented. Hopefully that summarized a little bit. And then also, I think one of the things that was really beautiful to pull up is just thinking about all of the cross connections between seemingly like disparate projects, not really disparate, but just the connections and the similarities of stories, family histories, connecting us so deeply across geographies. And what, for me, I'm thinking and taking away what that means to actually unearth and understand and find spaces where those could be shared and moments of engagement and deeper connection with one another, as also, you know, just thinking about a whole force, a wall force to fight against anything that might come in and try to penetrate. So that is my quick share back from the group, unless anybody else from the group wants to offer up. Sorry, I just hopped in to move us through, but yeah.
Are there, thank you for that. Are there two other groups that, I think there should be two other groups. Anyone want to share?
Yeah,
Betty. Sorry.
Yeah, this is Catherine. So I also give space to the participants in my group to share out. There was beautiful conversation around like intergenerational sharing, historical society conversations. It was really gorgeous. So I'm going to give the space to Celeste, Alice, or Akira to share out.
Well, thank you so much, Catherine. In the interest of time, we just continue the conversation about how to sustain and maintain our art of our communities. And we just found out a lot just in that sharing about the old space that was the Apollo on Fulton Street that is now a McDonald's that we didn't know about, talking about history. I shared about art spaces and venues that we used to have on Broadway, the RKO, the Lowy's. Akira did a lot of sharing with regard to a possible bike tour that's coming up that she's working on that would share history of our Bed-Stuy community. And an idea was floated and talked about with regard to a Bed-Stuy historical society that would tie these type of gems and beautiful places of art. And that's kind of what, in just a little bit, what we did and what we talked about. Thank you.
Thank you. That was a great summary. And did you take notes? I was like so impressed. Was that like from the top of your head? That's amazing.
Yeah, I was from the top of my head because it really resonated with me, as well as what panelist Larry Weeks said about Kingsborough, because my ancestors are from Kingsborough. And I'm going to get off this call and go dig through pictures and see if I can find anything, because that was fantastic.
That's amazing. That's awesome. Trisha, were you in a group? Maybe yep. You were the last group. Okay.
Yes, I was in a group. I'll just kind of give the preface of, we were discussing kind of the importance of political power, art, wealth, and how that all comes together. But I will let Robert speak more to that.
Oh, you put me on the spot. Let's see. So yeah, just first, like, thank you to everyone for sharing. This has been really, really a great conversation. And I've learned so much. I live in Bed-Stuy also, but I'm still learning a lot because I think it's important to, you know, listen to your elders. And I think our elders have come through yet again, dropping the pearls of wisdom. Yeah, so my question, I guess, it's more of a question, right? To thinking about the relationship between public art and these kinds of like social practices that we've been talking about today, to, you know, building political power and building like community controlled, you know, real estate and wealth. Because I think that everyone has sort of talked about that in their remarks. So what does it look like to for art and cultural institutions to support their community in like owning land, in collectivizing wealth, in like building and wielding political power to actually like get our fair share. And I think that not everyone who, you know, like all of our, you know, skin folk and our kinfolk, my mom taught me that one. And I just think that there's a way in which, there's a way in which the folks who represent Bed-Stuy don't always represent the folks who live in Bed-Stuy and are actually a part of the problem. And I think that goes for every community. So just really curious about folks' thoughts on how a specific public art project or an organization with a kind of community practice can help seed some of this work and like accelerate what's happening or complement what's already happening like out in the field.
That's great. Also super impressive at your very detailed report back. Sounds like a really rich conversation. I am wondering if we want to return back to some of the questions that were kind of put out that came out of your small groups, or do folks want to put out other questions? I think you can, you know, maybe unmute and speak them out or type them in the chat. I'll just give, I think if I can return to the question that someone asked, I can't remember now who at the moment, but around ways to find out, ways to sort of find out and make sure that you're not, you or your colleagues and artist friends are not the pawns of art washing scheme. And it's, I can certainly share some of my examples where I've had to do a lot of digging and soul searching, but also just practical research. I think that was such a really interesting question. And the Samantha Hill, the example that was a pretty public kind of story of artists who just were like, we're not gonna be a part of this. I think it was in Georgia, if I'm not mistaken. Macon, Georgia, right? So anyway, to the panelists, any thoughts around that? Ways to sort of not be a part of the art washing scheme while also not being, being blacklisted or, there's like a lot of stigma that comes with that. Any thoughts on that, Diya? I feel like you're having lots of thoughts, and then maybe we can go to Jamel and then Larry on this question.
I don't know if I have any answers though, but it is a really difficult question, and it kind of just exposes the structures of the art world, right? And I think sometimes or oftentimes the organizations don't even know what art washing is, or that they should be aware of it, or that tools are available to them to act differently or move differently in relationship to community, that they're often receiving resources, real estate from boards to do programming, and are so separately thinking about community engagement from those structures that run a space and operate a space. So I think like one, that's an issue. The other thing is a lot of organizations knowingly bring in community engagement as the kind of as the repair to bigger issues that they are confronted with without an appetite to make any kind of structural change. And then artists are kind of put forth as the face of repair for their wrongdoings. And being an artist is really difficult within that structure. And there is a scarcity of resources and opportunities. And it is unfortunately always up to the artist to decide if they participate or not. And I think and I hope that there's more and more cultural workers, and I think we're seeing this all the time, rally around artists and support, be it through public letters or contacting press for them or giving them opportunities so that they're not blacklisted, finding other ways to support them in the midst and aftermath of those really difficult decisions. I think that's our responsibility as cultural workers and administrators to make sure there's a home for artists that say no to being instrumentalized in that way. And I think the only thing we can do as individuals is our homework and dig into the places that we're going to be working with and talk to people who have been through it before. And we shouldn't have to do that extra labor, and artists shouldn't have to do that extra labor. But unfortunately, it's kind of what it entails to understand the situation that you're stepping into. But I don't think there's any good answer except that, like what solidarity looks like.
Yeah. Yeah. Jamel or Larry, you don't have to. I know there's a few other questions. We only have a few minutes, but do either of you want to address the question?
I think that was well said for me.
Yeah. I would just say one concrete example is the Museum of Chinese in America, which is in Chinatown, right? And it started out as a radical sort of history project of working class folks in Chinatown. 35 years later, 40 years later, it's this corporate institution basically, and they accepted $35 million from the city for their consent of a jail that is being built, as I mentioned, the tallest jail in the world in Chinatown. And it's the community give back. So the money that they're gonna use the money to basically purchase their space. And I will just say that a group of artists, they're called Godzilla, you may have heard them. They're pretty well-known Asian American artists activist collective that have a 35 year history. They were supposed to have a retrospective there. They started organizing, and more than half of the artists decided to pull out of the retrospective, which was gonna be a huge money-making force for the museum. And they pulled out and they made a statement. As a result of that, folks started creating alternative spaces in Chinatown to exhibit this kind of art, right? So there've been people who have literally just initiated, like pulled money together to rent a space to show work. Other spaces like Think Chinatown and the Wing on Woe, the WOW project, which is out of this old store, the oldest store in Chinatown, which is now a community cultural space, emerged. Not out of that specifically, but this idea that we can't rely on these museums and these institutions because they literally sold out the community and completely turned their back to the rich history of Black and Asian solidarity as well. And so that for us was just absolutely, you can't return from that. So I just wanted to, as an example of artists sticking to their integrity and pulling out of the show. Anyway, and of course, all the great things that Diya was lifting up. There was a question really quickly, I think for maybe Larry. Is the Macon Library's African American Heritage Center a useful resource for preserving and archiving Bed-Stuy art and history? This is a question coming from Robert.
No, it's not, and it should be. We've exhibited there. I've had several exhibits there at the Macon Street Library and planning things going forward, but it is not a research or archive facility. Should there be one? If they're gonna, you know, doing it at the public library is a different thing, I think. Weeksville would be a better venue for something of that nature. And if somebody wants to work on that, I will work with them.
I would like to work on that. Wow. I think that's something where I was in the group mentioning how I would love for there to be a Bed-Stuy Historical Society. And I also am a part of a group that recently is a recipient of a city bike grant. And so we have free access to city bikes to host community programming. And so ideally we want to do a bike tour. And so based on what you were sharing, I was like, I would love to just chat with you more about how can I find archival images of Bed-Stuy just to incorporate in a tour.
Yeah, one thing we did do for the art walk last year, and if you come out to Fulton Street for the, on the fence, there's a few banners there that depict Bed-Stuy history. So for the art walk, we try to document some things, as such as the Woolworths family lived there, and some of the historic and some of the cultural people who came out of Bed-Stuy. So that's a project that will continue with the art walk in October.
That's great. I hope you both can connect at some point, maybe via the chat. But I think we have time. I love the discussion that's happening on the sidebar here on the chat. But time for one more question, and I'm going to direct this one to Jamel for the closing, which is from Catherine's group. A question that came out of Catherine's group: how do we use the art projects we're talking about to build political power in community wealth and ownership? Can we use these projects to actually make sure communities own the space so someone else doesn't? I know that's a big question for like the last minute that we have, but anything you can offer a response to that, Jamel?
Yeah, definitely. I don't think I have a straightforward answer, but one thing I can say, it is so important, like that ownership piece. So even like with what I've been doing with the East Brooklyn Archives Project is us having ownership over our own stories, that narrative justice component. And there's power in being able to be able to tell our stories, to own our stories. But then, you know, there's the actual ownership of like the physical land, the spaces that we operate and where, you know, the work lives and where we hold community and space. And we need that, especially as we look at the changing of neighborhoods, the erasures of communities. It's important that we continue the conversation around collective ownership, create resources or spaces where folks can be educated on ownership. You know, there's the movement for affordable housing and rental apartments, but then also home ownership. You know, in East New York, there's a rising of Black-owned homeowners, and we want to keep that. That's folks who have been here. We want to preserve that, protect that, and see that going across the city and neighborhoods that are facing displacement. And like I said, I have a straightforward answer, but that's something I would just contribute to that conversation.
That's perfect. Yeah, and you had talked about community land trust earlier. Somebody's just reaffirming that in the chat as one concrete strategy. Nice. And not always, I know real estate in New York, it's not always the easiest way to get there to get a CLT. But I thank you so much, everyone. I think I'm going to pass it back maybe to Issa or to Trisha. I'm not sure who I'm passing to, but thank you. This has been a really amazing discussion. I've learned so much. Somebody on the chat asked if they could save the chat, if someone can save the chat and email it, because it is an amazing chat and a resource. So if someone could do that, that would be amazing. But I'm going to toss it back to the LP for closing. Thank you so much, everyone. It's just amazing.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Thank you, everyone. We are over time, you know, whatever, time is a concept, and like the conversations that we're having are really important. Thank you, Betty. Thank you, Larry, Mr. Weeks. Thank you, Diya. Thank you, Jamel. Thank you, everyone who gave time to pour into these really deep conversations when it comes to the dynamic relationship between public art and the challenges of displacement faced in our communities. We are so excited to continue these conversations for tomorrow's convening, which will be, I think it was me dropping it in the chat, but it's a virtual discussion on remembering and reclaiming our neighbors. And that will be taking place from 11 a.m. to 12:30. It will be coming into the chat. And we'll also try to find a way to make sure that we can collect or archive this conversation, as well as what was textually discussed in our chat, so that we can continue the importance of histories and pushing that forward and making sure that intergenerationally we're passing that along. Thank you, everyone, for being a part of this. And we hope that you have a wonderful night. You stay safe, and hopefully we see you all tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you.
Everybody, this is great.
Thank you so much.
Thank y'all. Have a blessed night.
Thanks so much. Yeah, good night.
Thank you.
Thank y'all. Have a good one.
Thank you.
Take care, everybody.
Take care.